The now world-famous painter was born as the eldest son of a poor farmer in Xiangtan County in Hunan Province. A child of delicate health, Ji was constantly the object of parental concern. In his early childhood he was never allowed to wander too far from home. His grandfather taught him to read and write between the 8th and 11th year of life. He liked to read and practiced to write by using a pine branch to trace out the characters in the sand. Qi Baishi, China's Picasso is the first book publication, which deals with the Chinese woodblock prints of original paintings by the great masters of China, an art form that was created after 1950. Detailed biographies, the story of the Rong Baojai Publishing House in Beijing, illustrated operations of woodblock printing and papermaking, 70 seals of Qi Baishi and their translation, many translations of the Chinese captions, explanation of painting techniques, bibliography, etc. In two languages, English and German. After the establishment of the People's Republic of China 1949, Qi was one of the most popular artists of the country. His modest background and his patriotic behavior contributed to that in 1953 the honorary title of Outstanding Artist of the People was awarded. In the same year, he became president of the Chinese Artists Association. What old man Baishi painted are river crabs, not marine crabs. He studied the depiction of the shell over a period of many years. In his 50s he painted only a mass of ink, and no strokes were discernible. Later he turned a mass of ink in two strokes. In his 60s he used three strokes instead, he was still unable to render the texture. Only after reaching the age of 70 did he succeed in looking the shell's texture. After the age of 80, he was able to paint the crab shell in relief. As the three strokes vary in shade, two small hollows appear left and right on the shell surface, fully realizing the shell's horny texture. In general, Qi Baishi painted the body of the crab first, the pincers next, and then the legs. Finally, he painted the eyes with heavy dark ink. With the exception of eyes and pincers, he painted all sections of a crab with the central tip of the paintbrush but slightly flattened it, employing vigorous strokes to depict something round and flattened with a hard shell. Moreover, as ink and water were skillfully applied to the paper's surface, there appeared suggestions of fine hair on the crab's body and legs. Because little Qi Baishi was too weak to afford heavy farm work, his father let him learn carpentry. However, Qi was still too weak to handle heavy tools, he had to change to learn joinery and gradually good at wood carving skills. At the age of 20 he had borrowed a handbook of Chinese painting, Mustard Seed Garden. This famous work, first published in the 17th century, awakened in him the decision to start with painting. For 6 months he copied the different pictures of mountains, flowers, plants, birds, and rocks. He could turn to art as a painter, poet, and seal cutter definitively only at the age of 27. Several local artists of some note were his teachers. But mostly he taught painting, poetry, calligraphy and the art of seal cutting himself. Taking the grandson to school was painted in 1930, depicted little Chi was on his way to school. In 1870 Chi Baishi began to go to school. His grandfather sent him to school every morning and picked him up every afternoon. This seems to be a worldwide problem at all times, that a boy does not want to go to school and is accompanied by an elder relative with gentle violence and understanding persuasion. Chi Baishi has adopted this topic in several pictures. With short and tight brush strokes it draws the attention of the viewer to the sad little student, whose red shirt stands in contrast to his crying face. This woodblock print by Rong Bao Zhai is titled Chi Chi, his oldest son, studying at night. Two lines of verse follow. Nobody cares for literature anymore, how can books retain any appeal? I really don't blame my son for being a sleepyhead. Red flowers and black leaves. In many pictures Chi Baishi was facing, in natural colors held flowers and black leaves, to produce a deliberate contrast between the colors and the black ink. Thus, the effect of color on the viewer was still fresh and clear. This reform Chen Shizhen, whom he had met in 1917 in Beijing, had inspired him. So that he was different from the other artists with this individuality. The success wasn't long in coming. The sales exhibition in 1922 in Tokyo was a huge success and brought the international breakthrough. This painting is not only bright in color but also reserved in temperament. A couple of mandarin ducks are paddling slowly under a pair of twin lotus flower stalks. This picture is pervaded with a feeling of peace and harmony. Painting buffalo. Once Chi Baishi was asked to paint a buffalo from behind. He painted the buffalo's body and legs with a few simple strokes and added its mouth and one horn, rendering the buffalo's typical gesture of turning its head to look around. He said, "Only one horn can be painted. If I paint two horns, the positioning will not be accurate." He added, "Special attention must be paid to leaving a white line beside the buffalo's tail. Without the white line, the buffalo's tail cannot be seen at a great distance." In adding the background I paint the slope with one stroke and the willow tree with several strokes. All these are meant to set off the treatment of the buffalo. Chi Baishi rose to fame thanks to Rong Bao Jai's collection and promotion of his work. They put a large collection of his works at an early time, to make them accessible as woodcuts for the general public and the world. Qi Baishi's artistic and literary legacy is huge. His oeuvre is estimated at 8 to 15,000 images, ca. 3,000 poems and 3,000 carvings. Morning glory. Together we coaxed an ox across the Magpie Bridge, but then I didn't have white hair. Alluding to the legend of the cowherd and the weaver, who every year on the Qixi Festival, which is committed to the Chinese farmer's almanac on the seventh day of the seventh month, can meet thanks to a bridge formed by magpies. A bamboo basket with a high handle is drawn in unrestrained brush strokes. The strength of the basket and the yellowish red of the peaches seem to overflow with beauty. Double longevity. Longevity is the first of the five good wishes and includes wealth, health, virtuous love and a peaceful death. Peaches are the symbol for long life and thus of paramount importance in Chinese culture since all times. In one of his many poems, he describes his embarrassment about the high prices, which his pictures already fetched at that time. I once used rouge to color apricot flowers, and the people were amazed, how every foot of my paintings fetched 100 pieces of gold. I have always been shy when my name was mentioned. But now people on land and sea know about old painter Qi. Qi Baishi's paintings bear witness to a universality that is incomparable. He looked at things with the eyes of a child and painted them with the hand of a perfect artist. In 1919, at the age of 55 years, Qi then settled in Beijing. Here he turned to the Chinese Zaiji painting. The easiest way to describe the Zaiji style from the Song and Ming dynasty is as Impressionism. The painting is marked by a concise structure, boldly executed and safe brush strokes. This was a shift away from the embarrassing accuracy of traditional Chinese painting. In Beijing, he could at first not take root in the local art scene and could hardly give his paintings away. Because of their guileless simplicity, Beijingers ignored him at best, or laughed at him at worst. As the former manager of Rong Baojie, Wang Renshan, saw his paintings and spotted his talent, it went up with Qi Baishi's sales. From now on, Qi's works were exhibited in the most conspicuous spots in the shop, and he became gradually more and more famous. Since that time, an indissoluble bond of friendship between the artist and the publisher was forged. This explains the large number of works which Rong Baojie published by Qi Baishi as reproductions, using the original watercolors and paper of the originals. As Qi Baishi had arrived finally at the top on the ladder of success, there was a huge demand for his works. This resulted in that forger wanted to benefit from his success. After printing with the colors of the original and on the same paper, the woodblock print is not to distinguish of the original and can be viewed as an independent work of art. Once at the Rong Baojie, a replica produced by woodblock printing and the original were displayed to Qi Baishi. But he was not able to identify which one had been made by him. The German art historian Otto Fischer writes about an encounter he had in 1926 with Qi Baishi in Beijing. The poet Abeta led me, as promised, to the master Qi Baishi, whose pictures I already had admired with him. In a humble booth, which consisted of not much more than a living room, situated in a secluded area, we found a little old man of almost 70 years, dwelling amongst an abundance of paintings and artist utensils, who gave us a friendly welcome. He showed us his works hanging around everywhere, and I was amazed by the freshness of observation power, the audaciousness of this highly unerring hand, sketching leaf tendrils, fruits and flowers, flocks of crabs or playing fishes in the water on the length of his painting paper. This painter uses, all educated in the old manner of viewing habits and composition, a perky stroke of brush with incredible surety, while just painting what he sees in front of his eyes, seizing the most extraordinary patterns of nature. And he combines in his watercolors the deep black with fervent colors like auburn red, amber, brown, etc., so the paintings appear to us as rather temporary and modern in the highest degree. And what a rhythmic empathy in forming the opulence of appearance into the entity of a gladdening painting. So I chose some pictures offered by the painter at ridiculously low prices, and would have liked taking much more. Then he wanted to paint something for me to bear in remembrance this day, chose the paper for a folding fan and sketched with amazing agility by heart an entanglement of branches and leaves on it, which he then accomplished with a couple of long, golden spots to a picture of hanging oranges. But the fan wasn't finished yet. The back should still get an inscription, and Chi Baishi wrote down after short reflection, in good fluent penmanship, a few verses of a Chinese poet and a dedication to myself. With this lovely gift and the acquired paintings, I left very happy the old master, impecunious but so rich and contented in the fertile abundance of his unfailing artistry. And I knew, even in painting art, the old Chinese genius still is as strong and creatively as ever. It never died and will always continue to reveal itself. Even after Chi Baishi had achieved fame locally and overseas, he still lived a modest life. He placed a big bowl on his drawing desk, and kept a few small fish or a few small shrimps in it. Chi Baishi did not regard imitation of nature as the highest state of creation. He maintained that the ideal state should lie between likeness and unlikeness. The theory would easily be misunderstood. What he advocated was that it was inadequate to just draw out the appearance of the objects. One should also convey the atmosphere and spirit of the objects. He painted as quickly as we wrote a word. With his strokes, the look, the feel, the movement and the spirit of the shrimp were all there. As if there were actually some shrimps swimming in water. The shrimps painted by Chi Baishi looked as if they were really swimming in water. However, when he painted, he did not just imitate the look of natural objects. He refined and improved them before putting them onto his paintings. Flowers, fruits, insects and birds by Chi Baishi were all lively and real. When Chi was young, he had deep love for living objects. He grew them and kept them, watched them constantly and sketched them repeatedly, and he grasped the nature of these objects. In his painting Shrimps, he had fully conveyed the three aspects of shape, texture and movement of the shrimps. Using simple and subtle strokes to express such a rich content, this was indeed the highest level in art.